Well, hello everyone, and welcome to this introduction to the scripting API version 2.0.0-beta, which is now available in 1.21.70 versions of Minecraft Preview. So what you'll see in version 2.0 of the scripting APIs is that it's actually pretty consistent with version 1.0 of the stable versions of the Minecraft scripting APIs. The vast majority of the APIs that you're used to using will continue to work exactly as they do today. In fact, the theme of this video is that it's not that different from version 1.0 of the scripting APIs, but in today's video, we're going to cover some of the major differences and some of the major improvements that you'll see inside of the scripting API 1.0. And first among these is the new changes to world load startup and how that functions. We're paving the way for adding new functionality into Minecraft. So to support that, we've actually added a little bit more robustness to world load startup, and we've changed a little bit about how it works. We've also made some changes and some improvements to asynchronous function execution. And then finally, what you'll see is that across the board, there's a small handful of APIs that have changes in terms of how they work. And I think across the beta process, you'll probably see a couple more changes to various existing APIs and how they function. So keep visiting the link to the article below just to keep abreast of the set of changes that exist for the various Minecraft APIs in terms of maybe some improvements or some changes. But let's get on to the fun stuff. So let's talk a little bit about some changes to the world load behaviors inside of Minecraft. So if you look at how the world load happened from a version 1.0 perspective, Minecraft would continue to do its major things when it loads the world, initializing state, loading the world fundamentals, level.dat. It would load all the different behavior packs. It would do some computation and some processing and those kinds of things. And then near the end of the world load process, it would actually load and start running your scripts that are declared inside of manifest.json. It would start to execute those. And it would execute all of the outer level functions and all the outer level context. And if you had any function calls inside of there, of course, it would execute the function and so on. But the one thing about this was that the world still wasn't completely loaded yet. It hadn't ticked yet. It hadn't started loading all the different chunks that maybe surround all the different players. So you're still kind of in a half-loaded state. Most of the stuff had loaded, but not everything. And so you had to be a little bit careful in terms of the kinds of things that your script would expect to do when you're first loading and running inside of a world. And what you'll see inside of scripting version 2.0 in its runtime is we've actually moved up the actual execution of running of v2 scripts to much earlier in the world load cycle that Minecraft invokes when it first starts up. So you'll see that even after it initializes a little bit of the state, but before it's actually loaded any of the world basics, it's going to start loading and running your version 2 scripts. We have a new startup event that fires where you can do some different types of registration activities that you'll see. And over the course of time, as we add features to version 2.0, 0.0-beta, what you'll see is that there's new things that you can register for and do inside of the overall Minecraft APIs. But the one downside to all this is that when you're running these scripts very early on in the life cycle of Minecraft, hardly any of the Minecraft state is available for you to actually go ahead and use. And so, for example, getting the overworld dimension, that actually doesn't work when you're running in this early execution phase of the Minecraft scripting environment. So what you're going to need to do is to register for this new world load event that we have, or maybe the startup event, or maybe just system.run and wait for some ticks to actually go call into your initialization code and actually go ahead and run it. So you can see that after this early execution phase, the Minecraft will continue to load the world, load the behavior packs, do some initial computation and processing and those kinds of things. We will load the version 1.0 scripts in a backwards compatibility mode. So one of the important points is that your version 1.0.0 scripts, if they are registered in manifest.json as running in a version 1.0 environment, all that should continue to run as is without changes inside of your Minecraft code. But if you want to take advantage of the version 2.0 environment, like you'll see, your code will actually run earlier on in the execution phase of the scripting environment. So that's a little bit of a summary of the changes to the world load behaviors. The other major change is a little bit in terms of a set of improvements to how tick processing happens and how your scripting is run inside of a tick. So when Minecraft does most of its initial activities, what you'll see is that it does all of the processing of movement of entities and applying damages and dealing with items and dealing with blocks and dealing with pathfinding and all of those kinds of things. And sometimes if you've registered for before events, this is just an example like a player interact event or maybe an effect add before event, it will actually call into your scripts and run them inside of a read-only mode where you're limited in terms of the set of APIs that you can access. But where most of the scripting action actually happens is at the end of the tick. And you can see that what we do is we process the asynchronous functions. These are the promises that you might have registered for. We run the job functions that have been registered through system.runJob. These are the opportunistic, if Minecraft has time to execute some code, please go ahead and do that. We'll call system.run, and then we'll process after events. And one of the interesting things that you can see in V1 is that we actually keep running the system.run functions and the after events continuously to kind of flush the queue of pending activities. However, unfortunately, the process async functions, that only runs once inside of the overall lifecycle at the end of a tick. And so this is really the set of improvements that we've made for version 2.0 of tick processing. All of the in-game actions and activities still function as they did before. However, what you can see now is that the processing of version 2 asynchronous functions, again, these are all of your promises and those kinds of activities, they will get flushed in that queue at the end of a tick. So that means that if you schedule maybe a sequence of different asynchronous functions, they're all going to drain in the same tick. You don't actually have to wait until the next tick before you can expect that any downstream asynchronous functions will actually fire and execute. So this makes it a little bit more effective and efficient to have your asynchronous promises run. You have a bit more of a guarantee that they're more likely to run inside of a given tick. So that just makes them a little bit more efficient to work with. Now let's go take a look at how the new world load changes apply inside of Minecraft. Okay, so let's just go test out how this works inside of 2.0.0-beta, but first we're just going to take a look at the code and how it runs in the existing Minecraft, the existing stable versions of Minecraft, and the existing stable scripting libraries. So we're going to get started with the terracotta example that you can find. We have a link in the description below, but this is really just our hello world example of working with scripting inside of Minecraft. So let me just come over here. You can see as I zoom into this sample like so, you can see that there's a manifest.json, but really nothing else inside of the behavior pack or the resource pack. Let me just go into the launch and just say that when we launch it, we're going to go into deploy mode like that. And you can see that the real magic happens inside of main.ts. We have a number of different script utilities. Actually, let me go ahead and install all of the dependencies so that I don't get these red squigglies. And you can see that in terms of the sets of code that we have in this kind of outer context of scripting, the global context of scripting, I guess you could call it, you can see that what we do is a number of different declarations, but most of the code that we have inside of the sample is actually inside of a function. And if you look at the bottom of this, you can see that we call system.run gametick. And if you go to the gametick function, you can see that inside of the gametick function, we actually wait until 100 ticks into the game before we actually call this function called initialize break the terracotta. So what you can see from this code is that it was designed to be very robust in terms of overall just waiting until Minecraft is settled and loaded before it actually does anything. Now it's a little uncomfortable and a little unfortunate that it just arbitrarily waits 5 seconds before it actually initializes, but that does give us a little bit of robustness to give Minecraft time to load. And you can see, and we'll see inside of 2.0.0-beta, how this is a bit more reliable with additional events and additional bits and pieces of infrastructure. But if I just come back over into main.ts, let's just go deploy this like so, and then let's just go see how this works inside of Minecraft. And you can see that for a good little bit before it actually goes ahead and starts to provision the arena that we're going to play the Break the Terracotta game inside of, like so. But let's go ahead and actually just make a couple of quick changes to the code just to change how it initializes. So let me come back into our function like this. And rather than just calling system.runGameTick, what I'm going to do is in the outer level function, I'm going to call initialize break the terracotta like this, and just get a head start on actually provisioning all of the different aspects of this game, setting up the scoreboard, calling into the dimension, making sure that any nearby entities are removed from the game. This code should generally work even if we're not actually waiting a bunch of different ticks for Minecraft to go ahead and initialize. So let's just come back into Minecraft like this. And what you can see is that this code still actually works in terms of actually setting up the world. In this case, I didn't do it inside of a flat world. It did it inside of an existing survival world, but you can see that the initialization still worked. In fact, you know, everything was just working quite well. In fact, it booted up more quickly. So even if we're actually calling that initialize the terracotta function in the outer level, you can see that very quickly things still kind of work with the way that the script initialization works in 1.0. So now let's take a look at what this looks like inside of 2.0. So I'm going to come over here and let's just go ahead and make a couple of changes. So I'm going to change my environment so this will deploy to the preview version of Minecraft instead. And then what I'm going to go do is I'm going to come into manifest.json and say that, okay, what we need is rather than 1.8.0, we're going to say we're going to run inside of 2.0.0-beta like this. And then let's just go ahead and deploy this over into Minecraft preview. And let me make sure to use the beta APIs experiment. Okay, and so what you can very quickly see, it just whizzed by in the screen, but what you can see is that immediately what happened was that we got this error that the initialize break the terracotta function world.getDimension doesn't have the required privileges. And what this is telling us is that in this outer level function that we're calling immediately when the Minecraft script runs, you can't actually call functions like world.getDimension and have that work. What you have to do is you actually have to wrap this inside of a function in order to see everything work as appropriate. So now what I'm going to do is I'm actually going to go and upgrade this code to better work with 2.0.0-beta. Even if this code actually used to run just fine in 2.0.0-beta because we used to delay the actual initialization of everything as I showed you earlier, what I'll do it instead anyway is just hook this up to the new world load event that exists in 2.0.0-beta. And I'm using the 2.0.0-beta type definitions over here. And what I can then go call is this game tick function inside of the world load event. And I can get rid of this code like so. And so now when I actually go and run this inside of Minecraft, let's go deploy this. Let's go create a new world. So what you'll see is that the world load event will fire and it will continue to initialize as before. And I could cut down in that overall delay before it actually starts to provision all the things like the walls inside of the world. So this is just a very quick preview of using the new world load event and working with 2.0.0-beta. As you can see, the code actually already ran generally inside of 2.0.0-beta, but with new world load events, you actually have a little bit better control over the startup of your worlds inside of 2.0.0-beta. So that was just a very quick overview of Minecraft scripting version 2.0.0-beta. Hopefully you'll agree that it's pretty consistent with 1.0 with a couple of small changes that we covered in this video. And if you'd like more videos like this, more technical drill downs inside of Minecraft, like and subscribe to the channel below, and thanks for watching.